So may you have a day full of love and blessings from the Lord Almighty. A very good morning to all of you. So in the previous class, we have seen how the vertebrata is being classified, isn't it? So we have seen it is being divided into adnatha as well as natostomata, that which is bearing jaws and that which doesn't bear the jaws. Okay, that which is lacking the jaws. Then it is divided into the adnathostomata. Natostomata is again divided into pisces as well as tetrapoda. And we have learned the short form of tetrapoda. How to remember, isn't it? Aram, the first letter. Okay, A for amphibia, reptilia, ants and mammalia. We have learned that. And also we have seen cyclostoma. Then we have seen the chondrichthyes. We have seen the stichthyes. Now we will be seeing the class amphibia. Okay, so moving towards the last portion of the class. So amphibia, as the name indicates, amphi, that means 12. Okay, bios means life. Okay, amphibia, 12 life. Okay, they can live in the land as well as in the same way it can live in the water also. So these amphibians can live in aquatic as well as terrestrial habits. They can live aquatic as well as in the terrestrial, both adaptation they are having. And most of them will be having two pairs of limbs. As you can see here in the image, most of them will be having two pairs of limbs. So body is visible into head, trunk. Okay, head and the trunk region. So body is being divided into head as well as the trunk region. Okay, the amphibia does not have scales. Instead of that, they will be having a moisturized skin over their body. So you might have observed amphibia. So they are having moisturized, okay, skin, moisturized skin. So they don't have scales. They don't possess scales. Okay, they are having moisturized skin. Okay, the eyes have eyelids. So they will be having eyelids. Okay, then a tympanum represents the ear. The only the mammals will be having the external pinna or ear. These do not have ear, pinna. So instead of that, they will be having a tympanum. Okay, that will be representing the ear. And elementary canal, urinary and reproductive tracts are present, and they will be opening into a common chamber called cloaca. So they will be opening into a common chamber called cloaca, which opens to the exterior part. So they will be having elementary part, respiratory, everything they are having. Okay, so the respiration is mainly by gills and lungs, both. So those which is in the bottom, they will be respiring by gills. Those which is in the land, they will be respiring through lungs and through the skin. Skin respiration, dermal respiration also takes place in the amphibia. Okay, then the heart is three-chambered. They will be having two auricles and one ventricle. Okay, heart is three-chambered, two auricles with one ventricle. And they are cold-blooded animals. Cold-blooded animals means they are able to according to the temperature, they are able to adapt the climate, and they are able to maintain the body temperature according to the climate. Okay, that is a special adaptation in this amphibians. Okay, then the next important feature is that the sexes are separate. Okay, fertilization is external, so they will be laying eggs outside. Okay, outside their body. They are oviparous, egg laying animals. And development is indirect. Okay, development is indirect. So direct development and indirect development we have learned. Examples we can say buffo and salamandra is another example. Highlights, creams, tree frogs is another example. All these are examples of class amphibia. So once again we will see the features of amphibia. First of all, you have to remember they are dual living. Okay, so in the case of bryophytes, when we have learned that they are known the amphibians of the plant kingdom. Why do they know they are known as the amphibians of the plant kingdom? Because they have a special adaptation. They can live in the land as well as in the water also. They are adapted in both the way. Okay, dual living. That's what they are. Bryophytes are termed as amphibians of plant kingdom. So here, the amphibia, they are living, means dual life. Okay, amphibians can live in the land, at the same time they can live in the water also. They are aquatic as well as terrestrial. Another important feature is they are aquatic as well as terrestrial. And their body is being divided into head region and the trunk region. They will be having forelimbs and hind limbs. Okay, and they are having eyelids. They have a special. They don't have a ear as we have, as we mammals have. We have external pinna, but here they do have tympanum. Okay, they do have tympanum, and they will be having elementary canal, respiratory tract. All this will be opening into a common chamber that is termed as cloaca. Okay, that is termed as cloaca. Okay, then respiration is by gills and lungs and through skin. Three ways of respiration: through gills, that which is in the water; through skin; and through lungs, that which is living in the land. They can respire through lungs as well as through the skin. And they are of three chambered. Heart is of three chambered. That means two auricles and one ventricle is being present. Then fertilization is external. Sexes are separate. And they are oviparous. That means we know that external development means the eggs, they are laying eggs outside. Okay, oviparous means egg laying animals. Okay, then they are oviparous and development is indirect. Okay, what are the examples that we have learned here? Buffo is one of the example. Rana is another example. Salamandra is another example. You can see here the example of salamandra and rana is given. So moving towards the next class, that is reptilia. Okay, moving towards the next class, that is reptilia. So the class reptilia refers to reper. That is a Latin word derived from a Latin reper or reptum. That means creep. Okay, creep or crawl. That's what the name. Then they have got the name class reptilia. Okay, that is derived from a Latin word. That is reper or reptum. Or that means to creep or to crawl. Okay, what is creeping and crawling? You know, so crawling animals we have learned in the primary classes. Okay, locomotion is there. Locomotion of the reptilia is creeping or crawling type of locomotion. Okay, then most of them are terrestrial animals. Most of them are terrestrial animals, and their body is covered by dry conified skin. Epidermal scales, or else or we can call it as cutes. Okay, you might have seen the case of reptiles, so crocodile. Okay, you might have seen snake, you might have seen the turtle, you might have seen the chameleon. All these are having a spiny body type, or some of them are having scales, some of them are having cutes. Okay, they are having tough endoskeleton. Okay, their body is covered with a dry and conified skin. So epidermal scales, or we can call it as cutes. And they do not have external ear openings. As I have told you, in the case of mammals, we are having external ear openings. In the case of reptiles, they don't have the ears. Instead of that, it represents tympanum. Okay, the cavity that which is they are able to hear. Tympanum represents the ear. And they will be having limbs. When present, two pairs of limbs are there. Two pairs of limbs. And heart is usually three chambered and four chambered. Except in crocodile, rest all the reptiles, they are having three chambered with two auricles and with one ventricle. In crocodile, they are having four chambered heart. Then reptiles are usually poikilotherms. They are usually poikilotherms. They lack the capacity of to control the body temperature. Opposite of homeotherms, I have told you, homeotherms means they are having the capacity to regulate the body temperature. And here, the reptiles. The snakes and lizards, they will be shedding their scales. That is called a skin cast. You might have seen some of the snakes, they are shedding their skins. That is termed as skin cast. Okay, then sexes are separate. Fertilization is internal, and they are oviparous, and development will be direct. So some of the examples we can see here. Chameleon is example. Chelon, that is turtle, is scientific name chelon. And chameleon is another example here. You can see chameleon, crocodile, turtle, snake. These four examples you can remember in the case of reptile. So whenever you remember reptile, what are the features that you can remember about the dry, qualified skin? You can remember the dry what kind of energy they don't have here, that represents tympanum. Okay, the fertilization is internal, they are oviparous, and development is in direct. You can see development is direct, development is taking place, and crawling locomotion is by creeping or crawling type of locomotion. They have limbs, heart is of 3-chambered and 4-chambered. In the case of crocodile, they are having 4-chambered heart. And some of the examples you can remember is that snake, turtle, chameleon and crocodile. Okay, these are the four examples that you can remember in the case of reptiles. Moving towards the other class. So moving towards the next class, that is of apes. So what are the characteristic features of the apes and the examples we will learn here? So what are the most distinctive feature of the apes? You know that they are having feathers. First, presence of feathers you can say. Okay, presence of feathers is the characteristic features of apes. And some, except the flightless birds. We know that flightless bird, ostrich is there, emu is there. Okay, all they are not able to fly because of their body weight. Okay, then they possess a beak. The birds possessing a beak. So with the organism itself, we can remember and write down the important features. Only the thing is that you have to remember the examples. Okay, then the forelimbs is, the forelimbs, they are having forelimbs and hind limbs. Forelimbs is modified to wings. So they are able to fly, isn't it? The hind limbs, they will be having scales and some are used for walking, swimming. Okay, all this for clasping. For these purposes, they are using the hind limbs, some of the birds. And skin is dry and they don't have any glands. Except in the tail region, they are having the oil gland. Okay, except the tail region, they do have oil glands. Okay, then endoskeleton is fully ossified. That means they are having the long bones. Okay, they are having the hollow air cavities. Okay, air cavities. So we call it as a pneumatic. And the digestive tract of the body will be having additional chambers. That is the most important feature of the bird. So the digestive tract of the birds will be having additional chambers with the probe and gizzard. So they are having probe and gizzard. That is the most distinctive feature you have to remember in the case of apes. And the heart is completely 4-chambered. And they are homeothermous. That means they are warm-blooded like us mammals. They are able to control the body temperature. So we can say it as one word is used here, homeothermous. Okay, they are warm-blooded and homeothermous. They are able to regulate the body temperature Okay, they have the capacity to regulate the body temperature. And another important feature is that respiration. How do they respire? They respire by lungs. Okay, air sacs are connected to the lungs for the respiration. Okay, they respire through lungs. And we know that sexes are separate. Fertilization is internal and they are oviparous and development will be direct. Okay, fertilization is internal, they are oviparous and the development is direct. So examples, we have beautiful pavo, peacock, and beautiful parrot, that is scientific name is Sitacula, and Struthio, ostrich. And we have here the first one, that is of neophryne. Okay, neophryne. So four examples you can learn: ostrich, Sitacula and pavo, peacock you can learn here. And crow is also example of apes. Okay, sparrow is also example of apes. You can remember, recall all these examples. So apes, once again we will go through the important features of the apes. First important feature is that the presence of the feathers. We can say the presence of feathers. Some birds are there flightless, so as in the case of ostrich and all, they will not be able to fly. So they don't have that particular adaptation. Rest all the birds will be having feathers. And another important feature that which we have learned, they will be having 4-chambered heart. They respire through lungs. Okay, fertilization is internal, direct development, oviparous. And then what else we have learned? We have learned a special additional chambers they do have, that is probe and gizzard. Okay, that is the important thing that which we have learned. And forelimbs is modified into wings so that they are able to fly. Then the hind limbs is used for walking, clasping, swimming in the water, all this special adaptation they do have. So examples we can record was, that is crow, Columbia, pigeon we can have. We have Struthio, that is ostrich, Sitacula, parrot, pavo is peacock. These many examples you can write. So moving towards the last class, that is mammalia. So about us, we are going to learn the most important features. So what is the most distinctive feature feature of mammalia, class mammalia, we can say the presence of mammary gland. They are able to nourish their young ones with the mammary gland. So this class mammalia, they can be found in various habitats. Means they can be found in polar caps, ice caps. They can be found in deserts. They can be found in mountains. They can be found in forests. They can be found in grasslands. They can be even found in the dark caves. So everywhere these mammals are being present. So in the polar caps, deserts, mountains, caves, in the dark caves, everywhere these mammals are being present. So we are going to learn the features. Okay, some of them have the adaptation to fly, like we can say that Pteropus. Okay, the bat is the example. So some of them have this very special adaptation mammals to fly also. And the most unique feature is that they are having the mammary gland. So the most unique mammalian characteristic is that they produce milk-producing gland. Mammary gland is present. Okay, by which the young one is being nourished, as I have told you just now. And they will be having two paired limbs that is used for walking, swimming, climbing, burrowing. For different purposes, they are using the limbs. Okay, skin. About the skin, if we say that they are possessing hair, okay, skin, they will be having hair all over. Then external ears, as I have told you, we human beings only have the external ear. Pinna, mammals are having the special feature that is external ear, that is pinna. Okay, then different type of teeth are present. Heart is four chambered, we know that, with the two auricles and two ventricles. And respiration, we do respire by lungs. Sexes are separate, male and females are there. Fertilization is internal. We know that fertilization, how does the fertilization takes place? Then they, the mammals are viviparous, and except in few cases they are oviparous. In the case of platypus and all, they are oviparous. In the rest all are viviparous. We have here the examples. Many examples are here. What are they? Ornithorhynchus, Macropus, Pteropus, flying fox, Camelus, rat, dog, cat, elephant, blue whale, tiger, lion, all this comes under the class mammals. So hope it is clear to you all. Once again, by seeing this animals itself, the organisms itself, we can write down the characteristic features, isn't it? So class mammalia, they can be found in various habitats. As I have told you, it is found in the polar region, it is found in the mountains, it is found in the desert region, it is found in the grassland, it is found in the forest, it is found in the dark caves even. Okay, so the most important prime feature of class mammalia is that they are presence of mammary glands. So they are nourishing their young ones with their milk. Okay, that is the mammary glands, presence of mammary glands. Okay, and the next point that which we have learned, the next feature that which we have learned about this one, that was that they are having limbs for the special adaptation, burrowing, swimming, climbing, all this they are doing with the help of limbs. And we do respire with the lungs. Heart is of four chambers, and heart to be the two auricles and two ventricles. Then we are viviparous, of course, we are viviparous, producing the young ones, the live young ones. And some are, except a few, some are oviparous also. In the case of platypus, echidna, all those mammals are oviparous. They will be egg-laying. Rest all are viviparous. So fertilization is internal, development is direct. Okay, so these examples you can remember: rat, tiger, lion, dog. Okay, human being, all are examples. Pteropus, flying fox, then kangaroo, all are example of this class mammalia. So now, all of you may be having a doubt. So many phylums we have learned. Non-chordates we have learned, chordates we have learned, and then we have learned the bilateral symmetry, coelomate, the respiratory system, circulatory system, all these things. Now we are in utter confusion. So how can we recall, remember these points? Okay, so you may be confused. So here is a chart, so easy to revise for each one of you. So with this you can revise each and every phylum. So first you have to remember the phylum. So already I have told you how to remember the phylum, isn't it? Then after learning this chart, we will learn in an easier way, in another way, how to learn the phylum in one sentence. Okay, so before that, first we will see this chart. Okay. Okay, so here we have phylum, level of organization, then the symmetry, coelo, segmentation, then regarding the digestive system, circulatory system, respiratory system, and the distinctive features. How can we identify? How will we be able to write down? That is the main important thing. So, as I have told you, we have learned, okay, Oryphora, Sinantrata, Chinophora, Platyhelminthes, Ascalminthes, Anemida, Arthropoda, then we have the Mollusca, Echinodermata, then Hemichordata and Chordates. So how can we remember whether all these phylums, what type of level of organization they are having? So I have told you, from the cellular to the organ system of level of organization, that means a complete organ is being formed. So in the first one, Oryphora, cellular level. First all, rest to tissue level of organization. In the case of Sinantrata, as in the case of Chinophora, also tissue level of organization. And here, in Platyhelminthes, Ascalminthes, Anemida, Arthropoda, and Mollusca, Echinodermata, up to baby chordata, organ system. And when it comes to the chordata, that is organ. Okay, organ system of organization. Okay, up to organ system. Organ system, where does it start from? It starts from the Platyhelminthes to chordates. You can remember Platyhelminthes to chordates, which is of organ system. Only this one cellular and tissue level. Cylindrate and this tissue level of organization, and in the Chinophora also it is tissue level of organization. And in the case of Oryphora, I have told you there is only cellular organization. Okay, there is no organ. Okay, and the rest all, Platyhelminthes to chordates, all are having what type of organ? Cellular level of organization, organ system. That means a complete organ is being formed. And next one is about coelo. How can we remember whether it is coelomate or acoelomate or coelocoelomate? So coelo is absent from Oryphora to Platyhelminthes. From Oryphora to P to P. Oryphora to Platyhelminthes, it is being absent. And you have to remember Ascalminthes, it is showing false cap, acoelocoelomate. Rest all are coelomate. Okay, from the Arthropoda, from the Anelida to chordate, it is coelomate. Only Ascalminthes, they are coelocoelomate. Rest all, the coeloms are absent. Clear? So that also easy to remember. The next one you have to remember is segmentation. Whether the body is segmented, how do we know? How can we recall from Oryphora to Ascalminthes? From Oryphora to Ascalminthes, the segmentation is being absent. Segmentation is not there. Okay. From Anelida, it is present. Anelida and Arthropoda segmentation is present. And in the case of Mollusca, it is absent. It is soft bodied animal. So, its segmentation is absent. And in Echinodermata, as well as Hemichordata also, segmentation is absent. You can remember that segmentation is present only in Anelida, Arthropoda and Chordates. Okay, three. Segmentation is shown by three. Anelida, Arthropoda and Chordates. Rest all segmentation is absent. That you remember. Three you remember, segments are present. Anelida, Arthropoda and Chordates. Clear? The next one is a digestive system. So how do we remember? Incomplete, somewhere it is incomplete, somewhere it is incomplete. How can we remember all this, the digestive system, regarding the digestive system? So you can see here, in Oryphora, since it is cellular level of organization, we know that there is no digestive system. And from Sinantrata to Platyhelminthes, it is incomplete. Rest all. Okay, rest all. From the Ascalminthes to chordates, it is present. Okay, the complete digestive system is there. Okay, rest all, it is absent and incomplete. Okay, three incomplete, and first one in the Oryphora is absent, and from Anelida to chordates, it is complete digestive system. And the next one is a circulatory system. How can we recall the circulatory system? From Oryphora to Ascalminthes, the circulatory system is being absent. And from Anelida to chordates, the circulatory system is present. You can remember the circulatory system is present. Okay, then the next is respiratory system. Respiratory system from Oryphora to Anelida. From Oryphora to Anelida, the respiratory system is absent. From Arthropoda to chordates, the respiratory system is present. Okay, then the next, distinctive features. How can you remember the distinctive feature? In the Oryphora, I have told you pores. Okay, pores are present. And canals, water canals. Water is being expelled and excreted through the same, expelled and received through the same canal. And in the case of Cnidaria, we have learned nidoblast, the stinging cells. Okay. And in the case of Tenophora, we have learned foam plates in the either side. Okay, with the tentacles they are moving. And in the case of platyhelminthes, we have learned flat body as well as the suckers are present. Okay. And in the case of Annelida, we have learned that worm segment like body. Okay. And the body segments. Sorry. In the case of Aspermillus also, we have learned that is worm like elongated. And in the case of Annelida also, we have learned segments, the metamerism. Okay, the important thing that we have learned. Then in the case of Arthropoda, we have learned that chitinous exoskeleton. In the case of Arthropoda, even it is said that even the nuclear bomb also is that then also that chitinous exoskeleton will not disappear. It means that will not be able to destroy. And they are having this jointed appendages. Arthropoda, they will be having jointed appendages that you can remember the distinctive features. So in the mollusca, you can see the external skeletal shell. Okay, they are moving with the house. He said no, snails will be moving with the hutch over their body. And water vascular system in the case of Echinoderma, you can see. Okay, water vascular system, as I have told you, water is received and excreted through the same system. Okay, water vascular system, respiratory, feeding, every function is taking place. And also radial symmetry. Body can be divided into equal half in any of the angle of their body. And here the hemipodenta, we have learned worm-like body, and they are having proboscis as an excretory pore. The body is being divided into proboscis, collar, and tail, front region. We have learned that. And the chordate, we have learned notochord is the main thing. Notochord, dorsal nerve cord is the main dorsal nerve cord, and another thing is that fins or limbs are the main features of this category. So I hope with this chart, which is clear to you all. Once again, you go through the chart. So, with the techniques, you can learn easily.
So, as I have told you, when the entire chapter gets over, I will be telling you how to learn in a tricky way this animal kingdom. I have told you, I will teach you, isn't it? So, here, there is a tricky way to learn the animal kingdom. So, as we know that kingdom Animalia are divided into non-chordates and chordates, isn't it? So first we will learn about the non-chordates, all the names, all the phylums that which is coming under the non-chordates. So how to learn that one? We can remember this sentence. Okay, pretty powerful cat placed an apple around the mouse which echoed heart. Okay, once again I repeat the sentence. Pretty powerful cat placed an apple around mouse which echoed heart. So first letter, if you learn this sentence by heart, then you will never forget the name of the phylum. Okay, pretty powerful cat placed an apple around mouse which echoed heart. Okay, so P stands for protozoa, PO stands for porifera, C stands for cnidaria, PL stands for platyhelminthes, and A stands for Aspermillus, Annelida, and here A stands for Arthropoda, M stands for Mollusca, and E stands for Echinodermata, and X stands for Hemichordata. So every first sentence, first word of this letter represents each phylum. So pretty powerful cat placed an apple around, mouse which echoed heart. So if you remember this way, you can easily recall the phylum. Okay, that it comes under non-chordates. Pretty powerful cat. So P stands for protozoan, PO porifera, C stands for cnidaria genophora, PL platyhelminthes, A for Aspermillus, A for Annelida, AR for Arthropoda, and MO for Mollusca, EC for Echinodermata, and H for Hemichordata. Okay, so non-chordates are over. If you send by heart and this sentence, then you will never forget in your lifetime. And the next one we are going to learn about subkingdom chordates. So only three divisions are there. How to remember? U, clap, vertical. Okay. U, clap, vertical. So if you remember, U stands for uropodes, C for cephalopodes, and V for vertebrata. So you can remember the subphylum. Subphylum Chordata, U, clap, vertical. U stands for uropodata, and C stands for cephalopodata, and V stands for vertebrata. And again now, we have vertebrata, again it is being given in the 6 classes. So how to remember that one? Cinderella is princess and remaining are maids. So Cinderella is princess and remaining are maids. So C, what is the C? Cyclostomata. Okay, so what is P? Pisces. R, reptilia. A, apes. And M is mammals. Okay, so Cinderella is princess and remaining are maids. In that way, you can remember the vertebrata. So, I have told you how to remember the non-chordates as well as chordates. So, non-chordates, you can remember pretty powerful cat placed an apple around the mouth which equal heart. And next one, you have to remember the sub-kingdom that is chordates. Okay, so you clap vertical. Okay, uropodata, cephalopodata and vertebrata. And another trick to learn the vertebrata is that Cinderella is princess and remaining are maids. So C stands for cyclostomata, then P for Pisces, R for reptilia, A for apes and M for mammals. Okay, hope these are clear to you all. So in this way you can learn in a tricky way. So, wishing you all a successful and lucky day. So, thank you for listening. Learn at home. Keep the spirit of learning and enjoy the learning. Thank you.